Well, good morning. Now, I know you've got your masks on, so you may not be able to just move that a little bit. You may not be able to sing, but let me hear you say good morning. Good morning. Come on, that's better. Marvelous, marvelous. It's fantastic to be here. But of course, in the lockdown, it's just brilliant to be anywhere, isn't it? And it really is a joy to be here. I was so excited when Jonathan and Kath said, we're going for in-person. I've been ministering for the last, 12 months or so, 90% of the time in my study in front of a camera. And when you're asked to preach on different things, or maybe you're invited to speak at a conference or a church event, and the only audience you've got is your iPhone, it's pretty hard. So I'm so excited to be part of a real gathering today and part of something where I actually feel a little bit of response from the audience, which will be absolutely wonderful. Even though you've got your masks on, you still look lovely. Okay, you look much better than my iPhone looks anyway. So it's a wonderful joy to be here. Thank you for having me. Thank you for inviting me. And it's an absolute honor to be part of your journey. I really love the privilege and the honor of just being able to connect with you guys 2, 3, 4 times a year. It is an absolute honor for me to do that and a great, great joy to be sharing with you. So thank you so much for having me. Welcome everyone and those online as well. And we pray that the Lord has been blessing you and will continue to bless you. As Pastor Jonathan said, we're starting a series today, and the series is called Together. Which is a good series title, right? Together. Now, the government, our government, is bit by bit unfolding the roadmap to us. And I don't know about you, over the last 12 months, I would not have wanted to be a member of the government leading our country, because you're sort of, whatever you do, you're going to get it in the neck. So it's been an incredibly difficult time, but we're all anxious to hear the roadmap. How do we get out of this and move towards some form of post-lockdown normality, whatever that looks like? And of course, the government are doing that day by day and stage by stage, and announcing how we're going to get back together. And that's a wonderful thing. And yet, as a Christian community, especially on this day, Resurrection Sunday, we believe in the power of together like no other community. I think as a Bible worldview, a sort of a Judeo-Christian worldview, we absolutely believe in the power of together. And it's on that basis that I want to share, not just today, but for the next 3 weeks after today, to encourage us, whether we are engaging online or whether we are here physically in the building, that actually we need to be committed to a roadmap of together. We need to actually understand that this is important for us as a Christian community, as well as for us as individuals. And over the next 4 weeks, we're going to be looking at 4 ideas to do with being together. Today, we're going to look at the idea that we are designed for together. It's not just a good idea, it's a God design idea that we're looking at. Then next week, we'll look at living together. The week after that, we'll look at walking together. And in the last week, we're going to look at going together. And actually, all of those things require togetherness. There are some things we can do on our own, but there are some things we can only do together. And that's such an important idea for us as followers of Jesus. So if you've got a Bible and you would like to follow a reading in this first session together, this first study together, as it were, where we're looking at being designed for together, we're going to start right at the beginning. So we're right at the beginning of the Bible, and we're in Genesis chapter 1. So it's Genesis chapter 1, and I'm going to read from verse 26, a few verses, and then we'll read a few verses into chapter 2. So I'll guide you in that. If you've never engaged with the Bible before, the opening page of Genesis is the story where God creates the heavens and the earth. And the opening lines are, the words are absolutely amazing. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. That's the opening statement of the Bible. And Genesis chapter 1 really unpacks how God does that. And in verse 26, we're sort of reaching the climax of this incredible event. And it says this, verse 26, Genesis chapter 1, then God said, "Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, and let him rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air, over the livestock, over all the earth, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number. Fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Then God said, I will give you every seed-bearing plant on the face of the whole earth and every tree that has its fruit with seed in it. They will be yours for your food. And to all the beasts of the earth and all the birds of the air and all the creatures that move on the ground, everything that has breath in it, I give every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw that all that he has made, and it was very good. And there was evening and there was morning, the sixth day. And then if you can jump down, if you're still in Genesis, jump down to verse 18. So just a few verses down, chapter 2, verse 18. And it says this. The Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Now the Lord God had formed out of the ground all the beasts of the field and all the birds of the air. He brought them to the man to see what he would name them. And whatever the man called each living creature, that was its name. So the man gave names to all the livestock, the birds of the air, and the beasts of the field. But for the man, or Adam, no suitable helper was found. So the Lord God caused the man to fall into a deep sleep. And while he was sleeping, he took one of the man's ribs and closed up the place with flesh. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib that he had taken out of the man. And he brought her to the man. The man said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, for she was taken out of man. For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united with his wife, and they will become one flesh. The man and his wife were both naked, and they felt no shame. Amazing opening sentences of the Bible. When it comes to thinking about the power of together, one of the dangers is that we can make it a purely practical conversation. And so we say things like this. Well, it's good to be together because I feel better. It's good to be together because it's good for my mental well-being and my emotional stability. And we've had a lot of that conversation, haven't we, over the lockdown and how isolation has really impacted. I've been really amazed and saddened and shocked and moved by even the conversation around young people, how young people have been profoundly impacted by the isolation they have experienced and how it has affected their emotional or even mental well-being. And so one of the challenges is that we can reduce the conversation to being together to a practical conversation. Well, if we want to achieve something together, we've got to be together. If we want to feel better, we've got to be together. If we want to be able to go forward together, then we've got to be together. And I get all of that. I accept all of that and have no problem with that at all. But when we as a Christian community are followers of Jesus, think about together, we've got to take one step further back from that. We don't start thinking about togetherness because it's practical. We start thinking about togetherness because it's the way we were actually designed. Now you say, well, John, what's the problem with that? Well, it takes the conversation beyond even the practical outworking and benefits of together, and it actually says, it's good for me to be together with others similar to me, with others who are following Jesus like me. It's good to be together because that is the way God has actually made me to be. Now, when you and I grab that idea, then the conversation of together goes beyond practicality. It even goes beyond personality. You know, I've met some people who've really enjoyed the lockdown. And one of the reasons reasons they've enjoyed the lockdown is because they haven't had to meet with people. They've been able to get away from people. Now, I understand that. I know there are some personality types love a crowd. My 19-year-old daughter just buzzes in a crowd. She is a capital E extrovert, and she feeds off the crowd. Me, not so much. I'm a sort of an extroverted introvert, all right? So I've sort of learned to be extrovert, but I'm really very comfortable, if you like, in my own skin and in my own space. So, but even I, in the midst of the lockdown, I've so missed being with people in the context of that. And I know there are some personality types drawn to together, and they go, amen, 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 we love this series. And there are others going, well, you know, I could sort of live on my own for a little bit longer. Now, wherever you fit in that in terms of your personality, or wherever we fit in that in terms of the practical benefits that we believe are there because of being together, actually, both of those arguments are sort of subject to a greater argument. And the greater argument is this: we are called to be together because we were designed to be together. Now, if you're going to take the opening words of the Bible seriously, whether you read them literally or whether you're prepared to sort of read them as a picture of what God has designed, it actually doesn't matter, because the meaning is exactly the same. What God is trying to achieve here is showing us that humans are dynamically brilliant as individuals, but they are designed to come together as individuals to do something bigger than themselves, to be something beyond themselves. And that's an amazing, amazing idea. God wants you and I to understand that together is important, not just for the benefits. It's not just important because of the personality type we have, but together is important because it is fundamental to our design. And if we are serious about a life of faith together, then we have to be serious about together. However we negotiate that, and whatever we like about that or don't like about that, and that's all part of the journey together, we have to settle. Actually, together is part of our design. And this idea was a game changer to me, okay? That this really changed my commitment to community, and it changed my commitment to team, and it changed my commitment to the idea of together. Once I realized this is not about my preference, and it's not about my personality, and it's not even about the practicalities, it's actually about the way I was designed to be. And once you accept that, then actually we can move with a bit of confidence into that. And as the government is releasing its roadmap, and we're looking more and more towards what's together going to be like, well, actually, that'll come step by step. But I want to appeal to everyone in the room and everyone online that actually we will be committed to the process of together. Whatever it ends up looking like, we will be committed to that process because we believe it's a fundamental idea to our human design and also to our spiritual design. Both of those are contained in this text. And let me just sort of, as it were, draw your attention to the power of that as we set this series up and hopefully set up a journey for all of us to engage with confidence in the idea of together. I'm going to ask and sort of answer three questions in the next few minutes, and hopefully will help unpack this a little bit. Here's the first question I want us to see. Who designed us? Who designed us? Because the who is behind this design, we believe that something of the design of that who is in the thing he designed. Okay, so there's something of him in what he has designed. When we look at creation in general, we're seeing something of the personality and nature of the God who made that in the world we look at. And as we come to look at humans, of course, who, according to the Genesis story, are the pinnacle of God's creation ability. They are the very good of what God made. And actually, we want to believe that there's something in humans that sort of reflects the design of that creator. And here's what it says in verse 26. I don't know if you noticed this beautiful, beautiful statement. It says, then God said, let us make mankind in our image and in our likeness. Now, three things I want you to see really quickly from that verse. Beautiful, beautiful verse. Let us. Who's the us? And what's really interesting, when we're introduced to God in that very first verse of the Bible, in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, the word used for God there is plural. It's a bit of a head spinner, that. It's not God in the singular, it's God in plural. So in fact, you could literally translate it, in the beginning, God's made the heavens and the earth. Now, what is it pointing to? Well, it's pointing to this idea, an incredible idea, that the God who made the universe is one God, but he's also a community within that Godhead. Now, that'll make your head hurt. If you don't understand that, don't worry about it, all right? Theologians for thousands of years have wrecked their brain over this stuff, and it will, because there's nothing in your experience or my experience that can help us with the idea that God is one, but he's also a community within that oneness. That's a very difficult idea. Within Christian worldview, we would call that the Trinity, where there is Father, there is Son, and there is Holy Spirit. We'll show you that in just a moment. But here's the point. If we're prepared to just even accept the idea that God is one, and yet he's a community, then this is hinted at in this verse. The God who made humans is saying, let us. So something is going on here that is reflecting a community idea of who God is. And here's what I love, which is beautiful in this verse. He almost repeats himself, and he says this. It says in the verse, let us make mankind in our image and in our likeness. And it's like a repeat. Why repeating the same idea? Because in the language of the Bible, the language of Genesis chapter 1, they're two different words. And it's a really clever little moment. The first word, image, is a masculine noun. And the second word, likeness, is a feminine noun. Now you can check that out. Now that could just be a little coincidence, or that could be a little code. That actually what God is about to make, he's about to make what? Male and female. And right there at the beginning, we understand that both male and female are representative of the image of God. He doesn't make male and go, oh, come on, I need something else, something to finish this off. Oh, I know, yeah, we'll come up with another idea. No, female is not a second idea to male. He thinks of male and female together, and out of the us of God, he makes something that represents both his maleness and, can I say, his femaleness. God is spirit, and out of that spirit, out of that community, he makes a male representation of his community, and he makes a female representation of that community, equal together, and both made in the image of God. That's such an important idea for us, not just in terms of together, but in terms of our understanding of humanity. Within the Church of Jesus Christ, there is no distinction between male and female. There's no inequality between male and female. God has made both in his image, and we rejoice in that idea. But we've got this idea of God making us, the let us. And in those opening verses, we see God making and speaking, and we see the Holy Spirit hovering. And in the New Testament, it says these beautiful words from John's Gospel. It says, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now the Word was formless and void and empty, and darkness covered the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Now that's from Genesis chapter 1. Now listen to John chapter 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him, all things were made. Without him, nothing was made that has been made. So we get a link. So in the beginning, we just get God making the heavens and the earth. But when John talks about Jesus in the New Testament, he's telling us that Jesus was there, as it were, right at the beginning. So in Genesis chapter 1, we've got God the Father at work, we've got God the Son at work, and we've got God the Holy Spirit at work. And I know this is a hard one, but just work with me. That community worked together as one to make something. And what do they make? They make male and female in the image of God. And why is that important for us? Because something of his image of community is in us. And this is so important. It's not just in us in terms of male and female, and people sometimes think of marriage around that, but it's in us as humans. That's why humans miss community. That's why humans need community. That's why humans crave community. That's why sometimes humans will even design destructive communities that are not good for them, because they're craving for something that is actually within their design. And so the let us, this God who is Father, this God who is Son, this God who is Holy Spirit, he makes humans in his own image. And how does he make them? He makes them to be together. They actually need to be together in order to fulfill the image that God has called them to. And that's an important idea for us as followers of Jesus. We're not just coming together here in church because that's the religious thing to do. We're coming together as a church community because it's an essential thing to do. It's not just something you do when you're a Christian. It's actually something we're designed to do. And when we understand that Jesus is at the center of that, that Jesus has a plan and a purpose for our lives, then it adds new dynamic to the coming together of that community. And we understand that actually what he's created in us is something that when we fulfill that, something of the glory of his design is seen in us and seen through us. And when humans come together, and especially when we come together in the name of the Lord, and we come together to worship the Lord, and we come together with him at the center, something amazing, dynamic, and profound happens in us and through us because we are reconnecting with our fundamental design. And that's so important as we go forward. So who designed us? A let us God. A God who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so when I look at my own design as a human, I realize I'm designed for community because I was designed by a community. Come on, are you with me? So, so important. And once we get this, it moves us beyond preference. It moves us beyond practicality, and it moves us beyond personality, and we start to, okay, I need to be together because I was designed to be together. Come on, you with me? So here's the second question, really quickly. How he designed us. Who designed us, but how he designed us. Look at this. It says in chapter 2, verse 18, the Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. Now again, three dynamic little ideas in this text which are really, really profound. First of all, we're struck by the phrase, it's not good. Now, if we've been reading the Genesis story, we've had it's good, it's good, it's good, it's good, it's good, repeated over and over again. In fact, in Genesis chapter 1, the phrase it's good is repeated 6 times when referring to God's creation. And then when it comes to the pinnacle of God's creation, humans, me and you, made in the image of God, God says it is very good. Now imagine we're hearing it's good, it's good, it's good. It's good, it's good, it's good, it's very good, and then suddenly, it's not good. And so our attention is grabbed by this. Hey, hold on a minute, what's not good? Well, we're told it's not good for man to be alone. The word there, alone, doesn't mean lonely. It means separated from something essential. Okay? So the man isn't lonely because he's perfect. In that sense, he doesn't know what loneliness is. He couldn't spell the word lonely, all right? So he's not lonely, he is alone. And what does that mean? It means he needs to be connected to something to make him complete. He needs something that will complete him. And if you're like, this is like a picture of God's original design idea that we've just looked at. And then what does it say? It says, and the Lord made a helper suitable for him. Very, very dynamic word. Nowhere in the whole of the Old Testament is that word used of an inferior or of something less than, but every time it's used even either of an equal or something that is superior. In fact, God uses it of himself. He says, I am the helper of Israel. You know, I look to the hills. Where does my help come from? My help comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. The same word here. The idea that my help is coming from God. So the picture that we're being given here is of God bringing something into the man's world to complete him so that the man, along with the woman, can do everything God has designed them to do. Now, let's just pause here for a moment, because lots of people jump into marriage here and they get the imagery of marriage, male and female, and I get that. And there's no problem. In fact, the New Testament sort of alludes to that. Absolutely. So there's no problem there. But I don't think it is the only application to this idea. I think what we're being taught here is that a person standing on their own is really special, but a person learning to live in community, something greater happens in their lives and in their world. That actually Adam on his own was special, but Adam with the woman, as it were, something now even greater kicks into their world. And that's the idea here. And I think it's a big idea that the Bible teaches us, an important idea, that the Bible celebrates individuality. It really does. The Bible declares, God declares, you as an individual are unique, you're special, you are loved, you are gifted, you are talented. Every single person in this room is profoundly unique and invested with gifts that can enrich and actually enhance your world. Now, I know some of you don't feel like that, and you look at yourself and you don't see yourself like that, but if you take a Bible worldview of you seriously, that's the only conclusion you can come to. You are incredibly special. Jesus died on the cross for you as an individual. Jesus rose from the dead for you as an individual. Jesus wants to give the Holy Spirit to you as an individual, and he wants to invest into you as an individual. And that is so important. The Bible celebrates that amazingly over and over again, where it celebrates the individual. But it doesn't stop there. What the Bible celebrates in the individual, it also resists in individualism. Now, this is an important idea for us, because the individual must never be allowed to stand alone. In fact, within a Bible worldview, the individual is constantly being encouraged to move from their individuality and to connect into a community so that the brilliance of their individuality is seen in the community. The more we throw ourselves into a community, the more people see the brilliance of our individuality. It's an amazing contradiction, and yet it is true. And so here I am as an individual made special in the image of God, celebrated as an individual in the most amazing way by the Lord, and yet the Lord is calling me all the time, move towards community, move towards community, move towards community. Why? Because your individuality was never designed for you alone. It's designed so that the community can be enhanced. It's designed to work in such a way, and here's a big one, and I think it's absolutely massive at the heart of this story. It's designed in such a way that the full potential of my individuality cannot be realized on my own. That actually, if I want to be everything I was designed to be as an individual, I must engage in community. The man was perfect, and yet he was alone. He was incomplete. And so God brings the male and the female together in this dynamic moment to show us that as individuals, we are dynamic and brilliant and special and incredible, and we carry the fingerprints of God upon our lives. And I believe that. But actually, we cannot stand alone if we are to be everything we were meant to be. Does that make sense to you? And if you're prepared to dig into that, that's a game changer. It's not that God doesn't celebrate my individuality, but he does resist my individualism, where me as an individual, I'm at the center of the world. Come on now. He doesn't want John Andrews to be at the center of the world. As much as he loves John Andrews, he wants for him to be at the center of my world, and for the community of faith, the community of life around me, to be part of John Andrews' journey. Hope that makes sense. Here's the last question, and I'm bringing this into land. Okay, so here we go. Why did he design us? Why he designed us? This is just a beautiful, beautiful thought. Look at verse 28. It says, God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it, rule over the fish of the sea and the birds in the sky and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Again, just three things. There's been three things in each little text that are worth grabbing on this idea. Number one, he says to them, be fruitful and increase. In other words, he says, fill the earth. Then he says, rule over the fish. And then he says this idea of subdue. So you've got fill, subdue, and rule. Now, who's he speaking to? He's not just speaking to the man. He's speaking to the man and the woman. He's speaking to both of them together. It's really clear in that text. He's speaking to both of them, and he's saying to both of them, fill the earth. He's speaking to both of them, subdue the earth. He's speaking to both of them, rule the earth. It's not he's speaking to the man and the woman's making the tea as the man does all of that stuff. Are you with me? She's not just helping him. She's essential to this task. In fact, here's what God is teaching in this amazing moment. Adam, you cannot fill the earth on your own. Just the biology of that will work out, right? You cannot fill the earth on your own. You cannot subdue it on your own. You cannot rule it on your own. In fact, the mandate of God for his people to the earth is designed in such a way we cannot do it on our own. No matter how brilliant we are, no matter how talented and gifted and special we think we are, we cannot do it alone. And actually, when we look into that, why has he designed us in the way that he's designed us? He's designed us that way so that actually we have to learn to come together in order to achieve everything he wants us to achieve. Whatever the mandate that God has for this church, it cannot be achieved because of individual brilliance. It will only be achieved by a commitment to togetherness. That's the truth. Now, you can say amen or not. It doesn't really matter. That's the principle there. That's the principle. And too often in local churches, we're looking to the individual brilliant people, the people that stand out. And actually, God has designed us in such a way that he doesn't want a community to rely on one brilliant individual, but he wants us to understand that we are together in this journey, that destiny will achieve this together, that even you as an individual need to be together with others in order to achieve everything that God has called you to achieve. What an incredible idea that is, and it shifts our thinking. And when we think about together, we're not just thinking about the practicality. Well, it'll be good for us, and it is good for us, and the benefits of together are scientifically and socially absolutely affirmed and without contradiction. Look at any societal or psychological test case on this, and it says over and over again, humans do better in good community. All right? Just, it's a fact. But that fact isn't just a practical fact, that's a design fact. That hasn't just come from our evolutionary development, that's come from something out of the God design within us. That together is not just practical, it's part of our design. That together is not just about my preference, but actually it calls something out of me to be more than I want to be. Well, I want to be on my own. Well, that's absolutely fine. But actually, if we want to be everything we're designed to be, we can't remain on our own. There's a cost to that. And we've got to understand that. So it's bigger than the practicality. It's bigger than my personality. It's bigger than the preferences that we have. And we're being called into something much greater. And that this is, if I can be really vulnerable with you, this has changed me. I grew up in church, and actually, I didn't even understand the power of Christian community theologically. I just thought it was what we do. we just meet every Sunday, and we'll have a prayer meeting, and we'll have a Bible study, and you know, then we had small groups, and well, I just turn up because that's what we do. And actually, that's fine at one level, but at another level, it's not enough. The Lord had to really speak to me about John. This isn't just about something that's good to do or something you like to do. This is about something you need to do. This is absolutely essential to the world in which you live in. And I can say with assurance, absolute assurance, that actually sometimes people say, and Jonathan today said very, very nice things about me when he was introducing me. But I want to say something that's absolutely true. And I can testify to this. It's the people around me that make me look better than I am. I want to tell you for a fact, if I stood here as an individual, or if I had tried to negotiate my life as a 54-year-old male, as an individual, I would not be standing here today. I wouldn't be here. I wouldn't have made it. Had John Andrews been left on his own to make his way as John Andrews, I'm telling you 100%, I wouldn't be here. And I'm here today doing what I get to do and being part of a dynamic community simply because of the togetherness that's in my world. And that may apply to my family, it applies to my Christian community, it applies to my wider community of friends. So important. When God made us, he made us a certain way so that we could function in a certain way and so that we could do everything he was calling us to be. And as the government starts to unpack the roadmap and Destiny Church starts to tell us, here's what we're going to do, here's the next stage, I want you to remember that this isn't just about practicality or personality or preference, but it's about your design. There's something in us that's better when we are together, because we were designed that way. Why don't you just stand with me? I'm going to pray. I'm going to hand back to Pastor Jonathan right now. But I just want to pray, even for this series, that the Lord will help us see afresh the power of together. That our enthusiasm for being together is even beyond just, oh, it's just good to be out. It's good to be somewhere. It's good to be with somebody. But it is even deeper than that, that we understand we were designed like this. So, Lord, I pray, even as our government is helping us unpack the roadmap towards life beyond lockdown, whatever that looks like for us all, Lord, I pray that as Destiny begins to unpack a roadmap for this local community, Lord, whatever that looks like for us in the next 6 weeks or 8 weeks or 2 months or 3 months, Lord, we want to be men and women who commit to this process because we understand we were made to be together. We were made for togetherness. We were made to function, not just as individuals, but as individuals flowing and living in dynamic community. And Lord, I pray that that will be a fresh revelation to each one of us. I pray it will be an encouragement to each one of us. And I pray that every single person listening and engaging us online and in this room, that Lord, there will be a fresh revelation of why together is important. It's not just our preference. It's not just our personality. It's not just because it's practically good for us. But Lord, because it's the way you made us to be. And I pray that even for Destiny, there will be an enthusiasm for togetherness, an enthusiasm to reconnect in every way possible. That, Lord, will not just come out of relief that we're getting out of the lockdown, but will come out of a revelation that we were designed to be together. So, Lord, may your grace and your peace be upon every one of us as we make the journey back together. In Jesus' name, amen.